الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters, it's always a great pleasure to come here to Kuwait and to this masjid because it's almost like my home in Kuwait. I come here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of you and bless this masjid and protect you and protect the masjid and bless all the activities that you do in this masjid. And I know the ICK does a lot of activities, alhamdulillah, especially with families and so on and so forth. Today the topic that has been given to me is marriage and divorce. So let me begin by saying that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you great barakah in your marriages and save you from divorce. Because I think that's the best dua to give to begin with. So I want to begin with saying a few things, which is I want to keep it short and simple so that we understand the issues that are involved. The first thing I want to say to you as a reminder to myself and you is that whatever we say or do, we must take into account Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu and His role in our lives. Today the all kinds of debates and all kinds of questions and all kinds of arguments that we see on various matters, not only this one, on various matters to do with Islam. If you listen to the tone of the argument and if you listen to the kinds of debates, it's almost as if people want to solve everything by themselves and without reference to the one who created the law, the one to whom is our return, and the one who will question us about what we did with that law. So it's very important to remind ourselves that whatever we do, at the end of the day, there is only one thing that the Muslim should be concerned about, and that is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu. I am not oversimplifying or trying to, you know, make matters too simplistic when I say that if this one single consideration, if we keep in mind, the rida of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu, nothing else, only this one. If we can keep this one single consideration in mind, then as far as any kind of issue and problem is concerned in our lives, where we need to take a decision, should I do this, should I do that, whether it is marriage, whether it is divorce, whether it is our dealings with our family, whether it is our dealings in our businesses and so on and so forth, all of these will become completely and totally simplified and easy to take. There is no decision that becomes, that is complicated. Provided that there is sincerity in the heart with regard to pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, Jalla Jalaluhu. Nothing else. So to begin with, let me talk about marriage and then we talk about divorce. And to begin the talk about marriage, let me remind myself and you of the ayat which is recited in every nikah khutbah, which is the first ayat of Surah An-Nisa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, Ya ayyuhan nasu attaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa bastha minhuma rijalan kathiran wa nisa wa attaqu allaha alladhi tasa'aluna bihi wal arham إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded us of this reality and reminded us of the fact that He is our Creator. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded us that we seek justice through the relationship of the Rahm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded us that He is the one who watches over us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, remember, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu,
through whom you seek these rights. Today the reality that we face, and this happens to me many times, because people come to me when they only come when there is a problem. They come when the marriage is sort of on the rocks, and then they say, please tell my wife what is my right according to the Quran, or please tell my husband what is my right according to the Quran, what is the sunnah with respect to how did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam treat his wives, how did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam do this and that. So I say to them, this is wonderful that you are so concerned today about the Quran, about your rights, and you are so concerned about the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But I wish you were equally concerned at the time you were getting married. What happened to this concern for the sunnah when you were getting married? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not take a dowry from any of his wives. You took a dowry. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not have sangeet and dancing and singing when he got married. You had that. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not have ostentatious spending when he got married. He didn't spend millions of dirham and dinar in decorating big halls and doing all of that stuff. You did all that, and I can give a long list of things. So I said, where was the sunnah at that time? Is there a sunnah with how the nikah should be done? Or do we think of the sunnah only when there is a problem? Is there a sunnah with respect to is the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with respect to the nikah? Is this something which we need to think about? And that's the reason I began with this ayat. And I began with this reminder to say that let us stop fooling ourselves. Let us look at ourselves and say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu, if I'm a Muslim, and alhamdulillah we are Muslimin, that Allah has a role to play in my life. And therefore, whatever I do, whether it's marriage, whether it's divorce, whether this, that, whatnot, all of that will be done only and only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. So what did Allah say about marriage? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ar-Rum, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he called the marriage one of his signs, one of his ayat. What is the role of the ayat of Allah? The role of the ayat of Allah is what? To recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. The purpose of the ayat of Allah is what? Inna fi khalqi samawati wal ardi wa ikhtilafi al-layli wan nahari la ayatin li ulil albab. Allah said, creation of the heavens and the earth and the alternation of the day and the night, these are ayat for people of intelligence. People who think. إنما المؤمنون الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمانا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. The purpose of the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to remind us about Allah jalla jalaluhu. So we recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah called the marriage, the nikah, one of his ayat. And that is why the nikah, if it is done according to the sunnah of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, is an action of ibadah. But only and only if it is done according to the sunnah. Not if the nikah is done according to our sunnah. Or the sunnah of our community or our tribe or our country or what not. According to the sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Only then does it become an act of ibadah. Allah called the nikah one of his ayat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, what is the purpose of this nikah? That you have sukoon, that you have mawadda, that you have rahmah. That you have sukoon in it, that you have peace and tranquility in it, that the relationship between the husband and the wife is a relationship of beauty, of harmony, of peace, of mutual support, of mutual respect. The husband is the best friend of the wife is the best friend of the husband is the greatest supporter of his wife, the wife is the greatest supporter of her husband. The wife thinks, how can I please my husband? The husband thinks, how can I please my wife? When people come and ask me to talk about the rights, I tell them, forget the rights. Talk about duties. Because you will be questioned about duties, you will not be questioned about rights. And the reality is that if you fulfill the duties, the rights automatically get fulfilled. You don't have to worry about that. If the husband fulfills the duties that he has to his wife, what is the duty of the husband to the wife? To cover her in mercy. To cover her in mercy, in rahmah. The rahmah comes into play only when there is a problem. Rahmah is to forgive. To cover her in mercy, not just a little bit, cover her in mercy. The right, the duty of the husband is to protect his wife, is to support his wife, is to respect his wife, is to fulfill all her needs, whether these are material, whether these are financial, whether they are emotional. This is his duty. So if the husband says, forget about my rights, my job is to fulfill the duties that Allah has put on me, so let me fulfill my duties to my wife. If the husband does all this, do you think the rights of the wife are getting fulfilled? All of them. No? It is her right. What is her right that the husband must cover her in mercy? It's happening because the husband is doing it because this is my duty, I have to do this. The other way around. Instead of saying, what are my rights to my wife? Let the wife think and say, what are my duties towards my husband? My duty towards my husband is I should serve him. My duty towards my husband is that I should obey him. If he gives me an instruction, I have to wait. My duty towards my husband is to make sure that this home is a place of tranquility and harmony and peace. This is not a battleground where we have to fight a battle every day as soon as he enters the door, start firing. No. My duty towards my husband is also towards the children, which is the upbringing of children. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi said the woman has only one duty, which is to take care of the children, upbringing of children. No other duty. If I tell you the rights that women have in Islam, many of you probably will be amazed. It is the right of the woman, meaning the wife, in Islam, to get cooked food. So amongst your children, the sons and daughters, who must you teach cooking? To the sons. Seriously. This is Islam. What we practice is what happens in our country, which is the job of the wife to cook the food for the husband. That is, we think that is her duty. Therefore, she must know how to cook. And she must stand there and serve. It's not, she can't just make the chapatis and leave them there. No. After he comes and sits, then she must make the chapati and then she must run between the kitchen and the dining room or whatever it is and give him hot chapatis. By the time he finishes one, she has to run and make one more and come here. This is not Islam, believe me. It is the right of the woman in Islam to get cooked food. If she is cooking your food, she is doing you a favor. It is her right to get stitched clothes. It's not her job to stitch clothes. So now if the husband says, all right, now this is what I have to do. I'm not saying you are not fulfilling the duties. I know you spend at least 6 hours in the kitchen every day. Mashallah, good for you. Seriously, go find out. I didn't invent all this. This is the reality. No one may have told you that, but this is the reality. The rights that women have in Islam, no other system, religious or otherwise, gives to women in the world to this day. The rights that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to women in the 5th century, in the 21st century, they don't have that right. They don't have those rights. But having said that, there is a big difference between the rights that Islam gives and the rights that Muslim men give. And that's why those who deny those rights to their wives will answer Allah. And that's why I began with that and said, fear Allah. And the women are equally to blame. Because for example, and this is a little bit of a side note, but I think it is important to mention it here. For example, the widowed sister of the husband has a right on the husband. She has a right on her brother. So if you have a widowed sister, especially if she has children, she has a right on you, that you should support her, that you should look after her. And that is the reason why you get double share in inheritance, because your responsibility is double. You are responsible for your mother, for your widowed mother. You are responsible for your widowed sisters. You are responsible for your unmarried sisters and brothers. That's the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you two shares, where He gave the woman one share. But what happens? The husband has a widowed sister. He wants to give some money to his sister. Who prevents him? His wife. Our entire Bollywood and Tollywood in film industry is based on what? Conflict between mother-in-law and daughter-in-law. Women do more injustice to women than anyone else. So the responsibility is on both sides. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this. Now, therefore, what must happen in a marriage? Number one, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, see the hadith. Who did Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, who did Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam instruct? When he said the famous hadith which we all know, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if you are able to get married, if you have enough money to support your wife, then get married. Who is he saying this to? To the men or to the women? To the men. Did he say to the men, if you have daughters of marriageable age, get them married, otherwise you will be in trouble? Did he say that? He did not say this. He said to the men, if you have enough money to support your wife, then get married. Because this is good for you, it is good for your emotional needs, helps you to lower your eyes, helps you to remain honest with integrity. So whose responsibility is it to get married? The woman's or the man's? The man's. 100%. So what does Islam say? What must you do? If you have the means to get married, then you must take your proposal, you must go, either your family or yourself, and present the proposal, propose marriage to the wali, the person who is in charge of the girl that you want to marry. Whether it's the father, brother, whoever it is. First thing. Second thing is, once they accept this, it's accepting them in the sense of, yes, okay, so this is, we are opening negotiations, so to speak. Then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, meet each other and look at each other face to face. There are two conditions in Islam where a woman is obliged, is duty bound to remove her niqab before a non-mahram. Two situations. One situation is when she gets a marriage proposal. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do not marry without looking at her. She must look at the man and he must look at her. She has to remove her niqab before the man, because he is not married to her yet. He is non-mahram. That's how she is marrying him. If he was mahram, she could not marry him. Second situation where a woman is obliged by law to remove her niqab and allow a non-mahram to see her face, and it's not only one, maybe more, there is in a court of law. If she is a witness in a court of law, the judge has been instructed, the qazi has been instructed, look at her face, because demeanor, facial expression is one of the things on which judgments are based. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah went to the extent of saying, even if the woman is extremely beautiful and even if the qazi is unmarried and he fears that if he looks at this woman, his heart will be affected, despite that he ordered him, you have to look at the woman, because as a qazi, this is your duty. And your duty and haq for the qaza, for the law, supersedes the issue of looking at a non-mahram woman. This is Islam. So what does he do now? He sends a proposal. He meets her face to face, not alone, with her wali and so on, people in the room, not just the two by themselves, but with the people, but directly face to face, see, talk, ask whatever you need to ask, satisfy yourself that this person I would like to marry. Then what does he do? In that course of conversation, they also discuss the mahar. Then he pays the mahar. Nikah is done. It is sunnah to do the nikah in the masjid, but of course you can also do it elsewhere. But since we are following the sunnah, inshallah, do the nikah in the masjid. And then he gives a walima. He invites some people and he calls them for this walima to announce his marriage. Who spent money in this entire transaction? The man. How much money did the father or the bride herself or her parents, how much money did they spend? Zero. Nothing. What is the job of the father? Participate in the talk with respect to making sure that, yes, this, since I am the wali, I must make sure that the man who came to marry my daughter is worthy of that. But after that, the job of the father is to go for the walima dinner and have a nice meal. That's it. This is the sunnah way of getting married. This is how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did his own marriages. This is how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam married his daughter. And inshallah, if we do this, then this is an act of ibadah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring all of this barakah into our lives. And that's why I began with saying, ittaqullah. Fear Allah only. Because the moment you say this, what will happen? People will say, no, but this is not our custom, this is not our practice, this is what we do in our village, this is what we do in our community, this is what we do in our family. You say, no. There's no need to fight with anybody, but say very nicely and politely, village, community, family, whatnot, first and foremost, we are Muslims. So we do what Rasulullah did.
This is what he did, so therefore this is how I will get married. I do not want to begin my married life with disobedience of Allah. How can there be any barakah in a marriage which begins the aghaz, the ibtida, the foundation, the beginning of this marriage is on disobedience of Allah. It is on going against the sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah. How can this marriage be blessed? I don't want that. I want my marriage to be blessed. Therefore, we will follow the sunnah. So in this whole thing, expense on the bride, zero. I'm saying all of this because I will link it now to the issue of divorce. Having said all of this now, the purpose of Islam is very clear as far as marriage is concerned, is to keep the marriage together, is to save the marriage, is to protect the marriage, is to ensure that the husband and wife stay together happily ever after for the rest of their lives. This is the purpose of the Sharia. This is what Islam wishes to do. Having said that, Islam also does not force you, does not lock you down into a marriage which has become untenable, which has become impossible. So if things have gone so bad that it is simply not possible for the two to stay together anymore, then Islam permits divorce. Now there are 6 ayat which you need to, you don't need to memorize them, but that's where the reference is. One, starting from 229 to 232 in Surah Al-Baqarah, and then ayah 1 and 4 in Surah Talaq. These are the ayat which refer to the issue of divorce. To put it very simply and briefly, what is the purpose, primary purpose in Islam, in the Sharia? To keep the marriage together. So Islam makes marriage easy, it makes a haram relationship difficult. That's why marriage is very simple. Easily get married. No problem. What I described, how long does it take? Everything can be done in one day. You do the nikah in the morning, do the walima in the evening, no problem. Khalas, one day. What does it cost? For the bride, nothing. For the groom, for the man, very little. Just the mahar. And then the walima. The walima, he doesn't have to call the whole city. I mean, whoever he calls. Islam makes it simple to get married. Islam makes halal easy. It makes haram difficult. Today we have made the halal so difficult that haram has become easy. Whose fault is it? Whose fault is it? In my country, we load all kinds of haram expenses on the bride. And the fathers and the family of women, you accept all that. Why do you accept it? Here in this part of the world, mehr has been made into a big musibah. Big problem. Well, this was not intended by Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say this. So, Islam makes marriage easy. It makes fornication difficult. Islam makes marriage easy. It does not make talaq difficult, but it makes talaq something that you don't just do just like that. So now, the ayat which I mentioned to you in Surah Al-Baqarah starts with 229. At-talaqu marratan. Allah said talaq is twice. What does it mean? How must you give talaq? This is also one of the things that I recommend to ICK. If you are not doing it, you must do this. Is have seminars for young people who want to get married. And in that seminar, talk about the way of marriage. Talk about the rights and duties of husbands and wives, and talk about talaq. It's very important, because today we have got to a state where if you ask the vast majority of people what is the way of giving talaq in Islam,
I will guarantee you that the majority of them do not know the right way. They will say talaq, talaq, talaq three times. Majority will say that. This is what the whole world thinks, for that matter. I mean, non-Muslims. What is the way to give talaq? Say talaq, talaq, talaq. Finish. That is talaq. La hawla wa quwwata illa billah. So what is the way to give talaq? The way to give talaq is very simple. The way to give talaq is to give one talaq, which can be done in any kind. You can say to the wife, I give you talaq, or I separate myself from you, or whatever, right? But once in her clean period, meaning that when she is not menstruating, before you have had intimacy with her. So there are two conditions. Talaq can be given or should be given in a clean period and without having intimacy with her in that clean period. So now, for example, she finished her menstruation and the husband and wife, they had intimacy once. Now the husband wants to give her talaq. Can he give her talaq now? Even though she is in a clean period, can he give her talaq now? He cannot. Why? Because they had intimacy. So what must he do? He must wait for the next menstrual cycle, which is after a month. He must wait for the cycle to finish, which is 5, 6, 7 days. And then in the next clean period, he can give her talaq without having had intimacy. What is the proof of this? The proof of this is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhumah. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhumah mentioned, he said, I gave talaq to my wife. My father went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, my son has given talaq to his wife. What should he do? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him about when he gave talaq. And then he said to him, tell him to take her back, complete this cycle, let her finish her next menstrual cycle when it happens, let her finish that cycle. After that, without having intimacy with her, if he still wants to give her talaq, let him give her talaq once. So what is the way to give talaq? One time, in the clean period, without intimacy. Now, why is this? Because you give her talaq once without intimacy. If you have had intimacy, you cannot give talaq, and then the period, you know, the time passes. The whole purpose is bring them together, bring them together. So even if there is anger and whatnot, okay, you give talaq once, now anger cools down, anger is not at the same level. Then you say, no, maybe this was wrong, I should not have done that. You have intimacy, that talaq is cancelled. So now you give her talaq once. Now what happens? Nothing happens. She still remains in the house. Allah mentioned this very clearly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do not leave the house. Read the Quran. Read the ayat of the Quran. She remains in the house. She is still your wife. She has her duties. You have her duties. You have your duties towards her. If you die, she will inherit. If she dies, you will inherit. Everything remains the same except one, which is no intimacy. And no intimacy is not a prohibition for you. It is in, if you want that talaq to actually happen, then for how long? For three cycles. Three menstrual cycles, or if the woman is of an age when she is not menstruating anymore after menopause, or if she has irregular cycles, then 3 months. That period is in the ayat of Surah Talaq. That's why I gave you a reference of both. Where is the period of iddat of talaq? In Suratul Talaq. So what happens now? You gave her talaq once in a clean period. Now 3 cycles have to pass. So that clean period, whatever it was, you gave her talaq on day one, day two, that whole month has to pass. One cycle, whole month passes. Next cycle, whole month passes. Third cycle. Why is all this time being given? Because of the original intention. What is the intention? Bring them together. Obviously, if the talaq has happened, family comes into the picture, people will come and say, what is this? What are you people doing? Look at the children, this, that. Bring them together, sit them down, peaceful
harmony, resolve the conflict, alhamdulillah, marriage is saved. The purpose is to try to save the marriage. Even if people don't get involved, husband and wife also, anger comes down, what not, you get together again. All right, so whatever happened, happened, forget it now, we live together happily, alhamdulillah, marriage is saved. If none of this happens, then at the end of 3 months or three cycles, as the case might be, she and you are separated, she goes home, talaq is final, valid. How many times did you say talaq? Only once. That's it. Complete, valid, khalas. If you do not want to get married to her again ever for the rest of your life, there is no problem. There is no problem. You don't have to get married to her. But Islam still leaves the door open. So what happens now? She went home, talaq, gone. Now you are living on your own, she is living with her parents or on her own, wherever, as the case might be. Some months pass, year passes, 2 years pass, she hasn't got married to anybody. Maybe there are children asking, where is the father? You also feel, no, I had a nice life, now I am on my own. I have to do everything myself. My wife was, she was okay, whatever it was, you know, people are people. So you say, no, I think we should get back together. What do you need to do? Nothing. Simply go, send a proposal again, pay your mahar, make nikah, you are married. Nothing needs to happen. Simple as that. Go get married to her again. So you sent her, you made talaq, 3 months passed, khalas. You don't want to get married to her, no problem. You want to get married to her, no problem. In the ayat and Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, specifically, Allah said, do not prevent them from marrying their previous husbands if the iddat period is over. Now, second situation. A man gives his wife divorce once. Clean period, one divorce. 1 month passes, 2 months pass, he calls her back. They have intimacy, over. Then after some time, again some problem, he gives her divorce again. Again, before that 3 month period is over, that is the condition, before that 3 month or three cycle period is over, he calls her back, no problem. They live together happily ever after, absolutely no problem. He doesn't have to make nikah, he just calls her back. They have intimacy, marriage is still valid. He does it now for the third time. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you do it for the third time, now this is qat'i. Now you cannot call her back. And you also cannot go and make nikah with her again. Unless she marries somebody else in the normal course of things. And that person divorces her in the normal course of things. Then if you want, you can go back and marry her. Why was that done? Once again, to favor the women. Because the intention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's intention in this thing is that you can't just treat that woman like a joke. You send her away, you bring her back, send her away, bring her back. She's not a football or something. No. Twice. At-talaqu marratan. Two times you have been given this chance. You can do that. If you do it a third time, it means obviously something is wrong. This marriage is not going to work. So, go away. Separate, no problem, live happily ever after. And Allah mentioned very clear, Allah said, when you separate, do it very nicely, do it respectfully, do it with love and affection, don't try to trouble her, don't try to, you know, harass her, don't try to oppress her. So even when there is a separation, it's not an enmity, it's not a war that you are fighting. Okay, so you could not live together, no problem. We separate, but we do that decently, like good human beings. This is Islam. This is Islam. Now, question will be asked. How did the three triple talaq in one sitting, how did it happen? Why is it that Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu allowed this and ruled? Let me explain to you what actually happened. In the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, people were doing this triple talaq thing, like, you know, the times change. So there were several cases of people giving talaq to their wives. Three times, and then they get them back. We say, what happened? No, I didn't mean it. I just said it. Now, having said that, just ask yourself, why would somebody give talaq? Why would you say three times? Why would you do that? Is there a logic? Is it a logical thing, or is it not a logical thing? Why would you say something three times? Let me give you an example. Supposing I say to you, come here, come. Supposing I say to you, come. How many times should he come? How many times do I really want him to come? Supposing he starts running back and forth, five times. Why? No, you said five times, come. So you repeat something sometimes to emphasize or for urgency. So maybe this man got so insanely angry, which is why, first of all, very important. Keep control of your anger. All this happens because of too much of anger, right? Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, a strong man is not somebody who wins a wrestling battle. The strong man is the one who can control himself, control his own anger. So keep control of the anger. But supposing you say, okay, in this great, you know, angry anger or whatnot, he said, talak. Go. So that's how he said thrice. So people started doing this. They did that, then they call her back, then they say, what happened? You gave her talak. No, actually I didn't mean that. I meant it only once and so on. So therefore, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radhiyallahu anhu ruled and said, look, if you have said it three times, as far as we are concerned, we are going to take this as qat'i, she's gone. Now, why did he do that? What was his whole ruling, first of all? His whole ruling was twofold. There are two parts to the ruling. His whole ruling was that if a man gives a woman talaq three times in one go, two things will happen. The first thing that will happen is that this three talaq will be taken as final, and therefore that marriage is finished, over, number one. Number two, the man will then be lashed 40 times. He will be beaten 40 lashes. And 40 lashes is not a gentle, like this tap. Generally, if you are lashed 40 times, you die. You probably will not live to tell the tale. Even if you live, you will be very badly injured, because if you look at what the lash means. So what is Sayyidina Umar radhiyallahu anhu's ruling? Twofold ruling. One part of the ruling is the talaq is khatai, finished, marriage is over. And same ruling. Second part of the ruling is what? 40 lashes. Why did he say marriage is over? Because he wanted to punish the man. How is he punishing the man? Remember what I explained with regard to what is marriage in Islam? Who is spending the money? The man. So Sayyidina Umar radhiyallahu anhu said, okay, so if you are in such a big hurry to divorce your wife, no problem, we take the divorce as khatai. The moment you say divorce as khatai and the man has given talaq, what does she walk away with? She walks away with her mahar. She walks away with all the gifts that you gave her. She walks away with whatever she had. You cannot touch anything. So she is gone with all that. Children are gone with her. You are now responsible for the upbringing and the expenses of the children until they reach the age of when they are no longer need you. Meaning if they are girls, until they get married. If they are boys, until they are earning on their own. Those children are to be paid for and looked after by the husband who divorced the woman. Even if she gets married to somebody else, his children he has to pay for. So now you said talaq three times, very nice. You get lashed 40 times after you come out of hospital from that. Now you start paying their school fees and this and college and whatnot. And then the chap wants something and he wants a phone and he wants this and he wants a car and everything. Give. And you are single. So now you say, all right, I'm paying all of this, but I still need a wife. Sure, no problem. Go find one. So now again, what do? Again, you go and find a woman, you go and give mahar, and you this and this and this. So Sayyidina Umar radhiyallahu anhu is punishing the man for doing that. What have we done? Especially in India. First you load all the expense onto the woman. You take a dowry which is haram. You load all kinds of expense on the woman. And then you say talaq, 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 salam alaikum, and you go away. What happened to the 40 lashes? I am saying if you are going to take the ruling of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, take the full ruling. How do you take only half the ruling? Take the full ruling, no problem. Lash one person 40 times and you see the fun. How many people are going to say talaq 3 times? You take half the ruling, why? Second point. We don't have to go to any of this. The ruling of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radhiyallahu anhu, as Muslims, as people who recognize the right of the Khalifa to make this ruling, and also among the Khalifa, the Khulafa-i Rashidin, Umar ibn al-Khattab radhiyallahu anhu, his ruling, do we accept it as a ruling, yes or no? We accept, there is no problem, alhamdulillah, we accept. However, when Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab made this ruling, did he say the ayat of the Quran are no longer valid, only my ruling should be followed until the day of judgment? Did he say this? He did not say this. He made a ijtihad, he made a ruling for his time, for a problem which was there during his time. Alhamdulillah, no problem. As far as we are concerned, this is a historical anecdote, it's a historical piece of information which we should learn about, we should know this. Alhamdulillah, no, nothing wrong. But if I ask you, what is the method of talaq in Islam, what will you say? You go to the kitab of Allah. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, this is the way of talaq in Islam. You say, what? Then I ask you, what about Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab's ruling? He said, no problem, that is his ruling. So how will you give talaq? According to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. You understand what I'm saying? What is the need for the confusion? Today we are getting all kinds of, going into all kinds of gymnastics with regard to the issue of triple talaq. For what? Is it valid? It is valid as far as Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab is concerned. In his time it was valid. Today what is the position? Today the position is the same as it was the position when the Quran was revealed, and it will remain the same till the day of judgment, until Allah removes the Quran, which is what the Quran said. What is the way of talaq? One talaq in the clean period without intimacy. Khalas. There is no need to go anywhere. You want to give talaq to your wife? This is the way. Keep away from her for 3 months, she is gone. Your job is over. So we talked about marriage, we talked about talaq, and what is the single joining factor between these two things which we need to keep in mind? Taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. I remind myself and you, my brothers and sisters, let us remain with that. Let us remain with the issue of taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu, and then you will find inshallah that your marriages will be full of barakah and khair. And may Allah protect you from talaq completely. But if and when you do have to give a talaq, that also will be something of barakah, that also will be something which will not break hearts, that will also be something which, where you part respectfully and with affection, so that there is no collateral damage in society because of that talaq. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalalu to be pleased with you, never to be displeased, and to fill your lives with khair and barakah and with his nur. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil kareem wa ala alihi wa ashabi ajmain bi rahmatika ya rahman rahim.